Funky Politics.
Hey, 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 this is DC. That's right. I try to come to you at least three times a week, so we can talk about those things that are happening in our country, right? What's been going on? Oh, the Democratic National Convention kicked off, and just some highlights on some things I've seen. Governor Andrew Cuomo made a convincing case why new leadership is needed in D.C. You know, when you try to leave from Bedminster Golf Course or Mar-a-Lago, it just doesn't really seem right. Or you're trying to leave from the back nine. Somebody needs to tell 45, hey, dude, look, we need real leadership. We need to get this COVID-19 virus under control. Unleash the full strength of the federal government, and I guarantee you we can get this thing under control. Look, Wuhan, China's gotten it under control. The province has gotten it under control. They're back to swimming and stuff now. Anyway, I want you to take a listen a little bit here from Governor Cuomo.
Donald Trump didn't create the initial division. The division created Trump. He only made it worse. Our collective strength is exercised through government. It is, in effect, our immune system. And our current federal government is dysfunctional and incompetent. It couldn't fight off the virus. In fact, it didn't even see it coming. The European virus infected the Northeast while the White House was still fixated on China. The virus had been attacking us for months before they even knew it was here. We saw the failure of a government that tried to deny the virus, then tried to ignore it, and then tried to politicize it. The failed federal government that watched New York get ambushed by their negligence and then watched New York suffer, but all through it learned absolutely nothing.
Wow, learned absolutely nothing. Negligence. Those are some pretty strong words coming from the governor of the fine state of New York, Andrew Cuomo, who is, of course, whose dad, Mario Cuomo, led New York for some years. I'll say this. That looking at that, I was convinced that, number one, leadership matters. Leadership does matter. And that the leadership that we have, and I think he made a classic case for it. Of course, President Trump did not bring the virus or create the virus, but he had the opportunity to set the tone how the country and the leadership of this country reacted to the virus. That's what we're indicting him for. And I think there's another shining indictment out there against a failed Trump administration. And that's lack of empathy. And that case, that charge was filed by none other than our favorite First Lady, Michelle Obama. And she made it completely clear. Unchecked institutional racism has run amok in this country. Jailing and caging of children has run amok under this leadership. And finally she says, hey, brutality and violence have become a way of life for some of our police officers against Black and brown people. Take a listen to the First Lady.
So let me be as honest and clear as I possibly can. Donald Trump is the wrong president for our country. He has had more than enough time to prove that he can do the job, but he is clearly in over his head. He cannot meet this moment. He simply cannot be who we need him to be for us. It is what it is. Now, I understand that my message won't be heard by some people. We live in a nation that is deeply divided, and I am a Black woman speaking at the Democratic Convention. But enough of you know me by now. You know that I tell you exactly what I'm feeling. You know I hate politics.
Wow. She hates politics. A lot of us hate politics. But she said one thing. She said, he is not the person to stand in that place in the Oval Office and take this country to the next level. She made a classic case for it. I think the indictment has been filed. We'll see what the jury decides on November 3rd. The voters are the jury. Voters, let me say this to you. If you say, well, what can we do, DC? You can do this. You can apply through registration. You can apply registration. You can have all of these things going on in your community. Register people to vote. You can educate people on why they need to vote, why they need to vote down ballot, why they need to vote for their congressional members, why they need to vote for those senatorial people going back to D.C. And finally, we need to mobilize them and get them to the polls. If you're good with what's going on in the country right now, then fine. This message will fall on deaf ears. But if you're not, you will do something. You will say, 45 is not good for this country. 45 has not been good for this country, and we're going to do something about it. And all I can say is a voteless people is a helpless people, you know? And that's, I mean, come on, we got to do something. And if you don't agree with me, hey, that's not the first time nobody's ever agreed. Hey, but speaking of something very positive, to help add perspective to what is happening in our country, whether it's racial injustice, black women leading in a time like these, or also what's going on with all these events that were planned, not only musical events, but you got theatrical events, you got festivals that were planned. All of these things now have come to a halt, right? So we're going to bring Deanna Roberts. Deanna Roberts is a principal with DR Roberts Event Management out of Oakland, California. Not Oakland, Tennessee, where my folks are from. Oakland, California. That's a kind of different state. But anyway, she's going to break it down for us. She'll be right back with us here on Funky Politics in just a second.
Funky up.
Extra cheese is $2.
$2?
Yeah, $2.
Hey, you can forget that. Funky
up. I got up and went to the gym at 9 o'clock this morning. We talked about on the show the kind of workouts I do. It's not fun. I work out until I feel like I'm either going to pass out or throw up. And when I get to that point, I'm just like, oh, I haven't done either. Guess I got to keep going.
The hell with all of that.
And then, like,
I
after
got,
that,
like, tasks and stuff, like, to do afterwards.
Exactly. Exactly. I was tired, boss.
Black Nerd Power on the KUDZUKIAN Network.
KUDZUKIAN! Hey, look what we have here. Deanna, how are you?
Good morning. On the west side, it's good morning. How are you?
I'm on the Mississippi. I think it's almost nighttime. I've been in. We're just hanging on. You know, in times like these, you have to just hang on, right? You have to hang on. You kind of have to hang in there. So glad to have you, Deanna, on the program today.
Thank you.
And I want to really get into a lot. I mean, I want to jump all over the place. You're such a world traveler. You're a thought leader in our country. You've been around everybody, and you know everybody. I'm going to get some of those phone numbers after the show, too. But anyway, so let's talk a little bit about your story. How did you get to the place now where DR Roberts is a well-known international firm that handles all types of events and marketing strategies for major corporations? And also, man, you just do the damn thing. You do it. How'd you get there?
Well, first of all, thank you. Thank you for having me on your show today. Yes, I must say it was just a blessing. I worked really hard. I actually was an econ major at UC Berkeley, and I worked corporate. But while I was at Berkeley, of course, you know, you like to enjoy some festivities, and I enjoyed, you know, throwing different functions and parties, and also just along with my friends and my sorority sisters and everybody that was there. And when I got to corporate, it just started from there. They asked me if I could help do a couple of things, and I was like, sure. So I started to work in helping out with my corporation that I worked for. But as I did it, I interned to check and see. I interned with sports teams. I interned with marketing groups. I just wanted to really see the overall aspects of sports and events and entertainment, and I fell in love with it. So while I did that, I wanted to get those 2 years in because, of course, my parents said 4-year college. I need some corporate work, too. So I did that, kept the promise. And then I just jumped after 4 years and went on my own. So wow. And what we do is we provide full service event planning for corporate, sports, nonprofit. We also can do branding and launching. And over the years, 23 years this September, next month, actually, we basically have now expanded internationally. Last year, we were in Brazil and also in Costa Rica and Cuba. And of course, we added Mexico. But it actually was just a blessing. It's been moving. And then all of a sudden, we kind of had to slow it down because of this thing called COVID.
I want to stop you right there because you said Brazil, Sao Paulo, I'm sure, and some other areas over there. Do you need anybody to carry the bags? I mean, I can be hired out pretty cheaply to do stuff like that.
Okay.
But seriously, you know, COVID-19 has been one of those things that has affected every part of human life internationally, not just in our country, but especially, I think, in the entertainment world, because there are some things that normally go on, right? And like you said, you're looking at the NBA right now in Orlando. You're looking at a bubble. We're like, well, what do you mean I can't go to a game? I'm always able to go. I got season tickets. Are you out of your mind? I can buy my playoff tickets. So, Deanna, how does folk like me who are so used to that type of interaction, that socialization, and a person like you who's used to putting on these events, how have you guys been able to survive without these major events?
Well, I'll be really honest with you. I'm staying connected with all of my colleagues. We connect and make sure that we talk and try to stay as a positive force for each other. I mean, truthfully, our events have shut down, and we really knew what happened when the NBA shut down. When we had a recession back in 2008, we were like, okay, I worked sports-wise, so my work with the Raiders and other sports teams basically made it okay for me. I didn't feel that hit when it hit the corporates, but this time we don't have that to fall back on. So it was when that word came across, at first I was like, okay, let's try to get through this. And then when that word came across, I'm telling you, we all kind of just went, oh, this is super, this is real. So it's been challenging. And it's that word everybody calls pivoting. people are losing jobs. I'm actually in a master's program where I'm actually, that has to deal with event planning and also business strategy. And a lot of my cohorts, they actually had jobs and they don't have them now. So it's been really tough and hard. And we're looking at possibly maybe not even really getting back fully until maybe even 2022. I mean, we're just trying to be realistic. Yeah. I'm hoping it's not. I have events that move to 2021, but I'm hoping and praying that we can get back, but we want everybody to come back safe. So if that means it has to be 2022, then we're going to have to be creative like we have been with this virtual and try to make it work this way.
Well, you know, I want to stay right there, especially with the NBA. I think the NBA and the commissioner of the NBA, and you know, God bless this guy. I think he probably made the right call, but I think it just kind of mushroomed after that. Mm-hmm. And because we were going into March Madness, teams had actually touched down in cities around the country. Yes. in these brackets to get ready to play, right? And yes, just so happens, the FCS was over with, but you know, had we recognized this thing for what it was in our country way before, February and March, it's probably, yes, here in January, they wouldn't have been able to play. So I guess you would say hats off to him for recognizing, but you have to say that, man, those are billions and billions and millions of dollars that were lost, right?
Well, that is true. And you're right. And everyone seems to bring that up about the fact that it's a lot of money being lost. But then, of course, you need to realize there's also lives. And I know this is hard because there are essential workers that are out there doing the jobs, and definitely they're in the front lines. But then you have us at home, and then some are like, I can't take this. I can't take this. But if you really think about it, you know, we have to, if we could have just sat back and just did nothing for that full March, possibly April, I think we'd be in a different situation right now. I am not a scientist and I don't play one on television either. So I do not know, but
I lie to people. I'm a doctor and it doesn't go over really well, but anyway, go ahead.
So I know that I'm an event doctor, but I'm a doctor of events, not of science, but truth be told, if it could have shut down, I think we would have been in a better situation. And it's just, the money is lost, but lives we don't want to lose anymore. And as you see, we've lost a lot of lives. And I agree with you. This was here before. I've had friends when I was traveling that were really sick back in December, but they thought it was a regular flu. So I honestly think it was a little more then, and we just had no information.
Wow. You know, I want to stay right there because I want to talk about the marketing piece. I mean, of course, you know, event planning and marketing goes hand in hand, no doubt, right? And so,
yes,
I don't think you can have one without the other. Matter of fact, you can't have one without the other. So those marketing dollars by Royal Dutch Shell or by Wells Fargo, and I'm just throwing names out there. I know that these are probably either some clients you either work with or you hope to work with in the future at some point. You know, the NBA, the NFL, those dollars, where do they go? Hopefully they're encumbered and say, look, we're going to hold on to those budgeted dollars because we know we're going to make a big splash and comeback. Or do we say, hey, look, it looks like in the future, we may not even be doing this kind of stuff anymore. We may just be doing conventions virtually, which will hurt those folks that you're talking about right now, the people who run these stadiums, the folks, the gaffers, yes, the utility men on these jobs.
Yes.
Which are considered good jobs.
I agree with you. So here, it's a little tricky. So here's the thing. Your sports team shut down. I'll just use, because as you probably don't know, I'm just letting you know, I'm a big Warriors fan. And so Golden State Warriors. Come on now.
Stephen Curry. That's his name. Stephen. Go ahead. I'm sorry. No,
Stephen Curry.
Oh, Stephen. You know, we're in the South. It looked like Stephen to me. My mom is that boy named Stephen. But anyway.
That's okay. We'll have a tutorial after this is over. I can give you this whole roster of the team. Okay.
Oh, Lord, no. I got you.
So, but the thing is that there's ways that sponsors and event planners and key stakeholders can work with their sponsor pieces. The problem is you have that question was twofold. First part is, you're right, when a stadium shuts down, we'll use the Chase Stadium right now. And the people who are working there, who are really essential because they work with everybody when they walk into the doors, they make sure your experience is awesome. It's a key part. Now, when they can't come back, and I know that a lot of the stadiums actually gave money to help them so they can actually survive, but it's only so much. So those, a lot of those people were retired and had extra funds were coming from this work. Some people actually, that was their sole dollars that were coming into the house. And over here in Oakland, the Raiders, when they were here, and also the A's, they were connected to the same stadium. So those people worked that job for the Raiders, the baseball, and then Warriors. So all that now is gone.
Wow.
So they don't have that. And so with the sponsors, like what we've been doing with some of our virtual events, we've been providing the sponsors the same amount of benefits that they're getting, except for just not live. So you have to be really creative. So for an example, when we have, okay, you're going to get live, you'll be able to be backstage, or you get VIP access, or you get to meet with the CEO, or you get to meet with the MC. We had to turn that into a virtual piece so they could still get it. So we can keep their dollars, of course, and you want to make sure. But those are the ways they're going to have to start doing things now. And it's going to be more of like a television marketing piece than you will if you were on live doing the actual live interactive piece. So those are the two things that I think can keep on moving. But as regard to people working, there's no way to get them back. There's no stadium pieces for them to work on.
Well, you know, and I want to stay right there because, and I didn't include this query in my notes when I sent them to you, mm-hmm. but Oakland, you know, Oakland has really lost a lot lately because, as you were saying, I think the A's have moved, the Raiders are gone, right? And so then you've got that team that used to play in Oakland. They were the Kansas City Warriors or somebody like that. So they're playing down in San Francisco, right? And so okay. What happened to Alameda County? I mean, what happened? Oakland is a storied city with plenty of sports.
Yeah, I'm used
to uprooting and get out of there.
Well, you know, I'm used to all you guys giving me a hard time with this, so that's okay. But so first, the A's are still here, living strong. I can see the stadium from my house. They're still here. Okay.
They're able to live up top, right? Hey, praise the Lord.
And then, okay. You're so bad. And then they are, if they do move, they're going to move to just downtown when that works out. So they're not leaving, so which is great. Yes, the Oakland Raiders are now Las Vegas Raiders. And yes, they did make their move. Does that hurt my heart? Yes, it does. But and then we still have the Warriors has moved out. They've gone to the San Francisco. But here in the Bay, either you're going to be a Raider fan or a 49er fan. But in between those two, football or A's or baseball fans, you still have the basketball, which a lot of people still are a Golden State Warriors fan. So we're just going to have to. We have to pivot in that too. In the sports area, I got to pivot, but you know, that's just kind of works. But yes, we have lost quite a bit. And I'm hoping that something will come and they'll do something here and also make sure they utilize the stadium and then actually make it more for the people so that now, since we are losing something that's kind of iconic here, that we'll still put something back that's for the community and for our the neighborhood around it.
And COVID didn't have anything to do with, the Raiders leaving or either the Warriors leaving. This was something that was in the plans. And I understand, and I think a lot of us understand, that you build them newer, you build them shinier, and somebody else will wave a dollar. And guess what? Some of those owners will leave, right? And we've seen it all over the country. I don't think there's any doubt that happens. But I want to know, how has that affected the city right now? because number one, when I was there, I saw a lot of depravity. I saw a lot of homelessness. I saw people living under bridges, and that hurt my heart, because even in the South, we have some homelessness, but it's not as severe as I saw in the city of Oakland. I was really surprised by that.
Well, you're absolutely correct. Homeless is a big deal here, especially because of, you know, we have to just be honest. Our cost of living is very high. Mm. You can't find, like, I mean, some places I've been to and I've seen people live and buy houses that can cost them what a down payment is for just here. And it's a one bedroom here. So it's the cost of living is very high, which causes is a part of the homelessness. Right now through COVID, we were just having this conversation the other day. There is a lot of homeless people under the bridges, under places. I know that our city has tried to put up little home houses to help them, trying to do things they can, but it's just, it has to be something that's have been worked on like months and years prior, because when it really hits hard, it's really hard for you to try to make up or be, have to be reactive on it. And so it's a tough thing. We have it. San Francisco has it. And the other part too, is that I've heard these things that, like, when you're in another location, when there's snow, you don't have as many because it's so cold, but here we have nice weather. So once they get in a situation and they find a group and a home, a group of people who are doing the same, they work together collectively. And so that's how it keeps going until the city can really come in, change some things and get some more affordable housing, make sure that we have access to all that they need and also job opportunities. That's when we'll start getting some of the homeless off. But you're right. And I can't even lie. I love Oakland, but we do have a lot of homeless people, and it's unfortunate.
Yep. Well, it sounds like that you may have a future career in politics, because I think you just made a great case for how do we try to attack the issue, and that's facing it head on and saying that we've got people who have been basically outpriced. They can't afford anything here. And I've heard about, I was in Sausalito a year ago and was walking around and looked at some apartments there, and they were $4,800 a month. That's just two bedrooms and a bath. And I'm like, yeah, Daryl, you won't be going there for sure, you know. So I just, New York, you find it in Chicago, of course, LA, you mean in San Diego. I understand that, but at some point I think for everyday Americans, some of us are really being priced outside the market where we just cannot afford to be able to live what we consider to be the abundant life, right?
No, you're right. And I have friends that have made the conscious decision to move. I really just love California. I was born and raised Southern California first, moved to Sacramento, then got to the Bay through school. I love it. I've been thankful and blessed that I've been able to purchase a home back when it was a little not as high. And so I have my foot in the market. But now if I wanted to buy something else, I'm just like, okay, it'll be smaller than what I have. And it's just crazy. So I know why we love it here, but I wish there was a way that we could bring it down. And when I have friends that come and visit, they're like, oh my gosh, it's so expensive, but it doesn't hit me because I'm so used to it. Mm-hmm. But during this COVID, when you need to look through all your stuff and see what you're spending, then you really start to see, like, are you kidding me? I'm spending this and this and this. So it's a tough thing. I hope we could work it out. I mean, Oakland before. So I fell in love with Oakland right when I was graduating from UC Berkeley, and people did not want to live here. They were like, oh, saying everything. Or they say, where are you from? And they were like, oh, you know, the Bay. And I would be like, Oakland, but you know, and now, I'm like, Oakland, what's
going on? So, no, you're absolutely right.
See, look at you.
I just sounded like, whoa, man, you know, but I was scared to Oakland back then. Like, oh.
It's true. And so now if you come here and visit, it is gentrification to its best. And
I got a pastor of mine, Dr. Haynes, who
BB Memorial.
BB Memorial. I was at BB Memorial, and I'm walking down. Oh my God, this church is in a really tough neighborhood. I walk out after service. I'm seeing your melon deprived friends. I'm like, where they come from? Oh, wait a minute, now, you're in the wrong neighborhood. And they were just as much a part of the fabric as what I would have thought we were in that part of the town, right?
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, but I want to pivot to something real quick, and then before we get out, and that's COVID-19. how has it affected D.R. Roberts in terms of, and I know we talked a little bit about it, but mm-hmm. from a bottom line perspective, from a pivot perspective, have you gone to that virtual piece now? Have you gotten that under your belt where you just really got it down pat and you're ready to say, hey, look, D.R. Roberts now is a virtual company, so to speak?
Well, two things on that. COVID has hit home hard on D.R. Roberts Management, meaning that I actually have COVID. I did. And in regards to the company, the one thing I will say, because we were doing so many different things, I mean, sometimes you're so busy and you're just making your current services awesome for your clients, right? But you don't realize that you're really setting up yourself for something else. And so with an event planner, you have a plan A, a plan B, a plan C. I have all the way to a plan Z because I just want to make sure I'm covered. Okay. But within that plan, those plans, I was doing, some of our events were being sold out. So we needed to have a way for people to be able to still attend. That was your live streaming, right? Mm. And when I would do an actual gala, I would be in the back because I'm involved in script writing. I'm involved in making sure that the big screens have people's faces. The AV guys are on point, the music on point. So I'm doing all that as well as coordinating the actual event. But when I stepped back and took a look, I was like, you know what? We are producing these events virtually. We just have them live. So really we had a hybrid going on. And so right now, because we cannot do full hybrid, we can't do a hybrid, because we can't do live, but we can do virtual. So I just took it, looked at it, did some changes, started doing some really good, pulling my team together that we always worked with. And already in the last 2 weeks, we've already done two virtual events. One was a virtual graduation celebration with the different celebrity guests that came in and said hi to the students. Oh, wow. And then we also, and that was for East Oakland Youth Development Center. And then we also just did a virtual 50th anniversary gala for Tri-City Health Center, who is now considered BOC. And so that included, we were working on that one for the hospital for a year and a half prior. So we had to change. We still gave the clients what they were asking for, the whole experience. They got items to their home. So we made it really into an event that was just as if you were live, just not touching and feeling everybody and able to say hi and hugs and see all that. So we have definitely, and I enjoyed actually, I found it to be really fun. But it's still full of coordination and it's still full production.
Well, you know, it sounds like that you're in a new space, what it sounds like. And that, of course, what you're saying is that I've taken what I used to, when I used to stand back there, now I can sit here in an office and we can coordinate this thing all over the country and make sure that people are still getting that value added. And I think that's what the clients, they want value added. They know they can't be there, right? But mm-hmm. I want the next best thing. I want a camera on something so I can get it out there. Why? You know,
yes.
Pivoting toward racial injustice in our country. I know, and I want to make sure I get you on the record all this stuff because I know you're Oakland, so you know, speaking of, they know everything in Oakland. But anyway,
Oakland.
as a black woman, and you worked in the corporate space, you're running your own company. Have you ever had that opportunity where you walked into a boardroom to present, and all of a sudden, you know, you felt it in your sanctified spirit that I'm not who they were looking for. I'm not who they thought. Does that harm some of those newer women, our black sisters who get these particular, I mean, as you are in a space where I've made it, but now you get there and you still are not good enough. Have you felt that way in terms?
Oh, yes, all the time. I mean, it's just unfortunate, but it has happened. I mean, it happened in corporate. I used to talk about this with my dad when he was alive all the time. You have to be prepared and be ready. It's going to happen regardless of what you're doing. And it happened. So yes, have I, because when they hear my voice on the phone, they think I have a Valley Girl sound, or I don't sound, as they say, quite ethnic at times, or black at times. And so when I walk in the door, they don't expect this tall black woman. So, you know, and so then I have to work a little harder to make them feel comfortable. And yes, and I've had clients say things to me, like once we had our President Obama was our president, they had declined having us do some work because they're like, okay, well, you've got your president and now we're going to go ahead and work with some other people. So, I mean, I've heard it all. Well, I shouldn't say all. I've heard a lot, and a lot that I felt really after I worked really hard, because, you know, when you're younger, you're taught certain, you know, it depends on your family. But I know my family was very pro-education. We had to have a four-year college degree. We had to make sure that we were ready. We had to be 10 times better. And so we expected when we do all that, that we would be considered equal. And that's not what happens. And even to this day, I still will get it. I'll have people grab, before COVID, I would have people take jobs that I knew they weren't qualified for, but they didn't like my skin color. So, you know, I had to, after a while, just look at it like this, you know, what, as my mom would say, and my dad, what's for me, God has it. So I had to look at it that way, because otherwise every day I'll be sitting here, you know, feeling some type of way. So it is tough. It's still tough.
But, you know, Deanna, you have, and I don't want to harp on them, but you have these millennials, and I say millennials because God love them. They grew up in a different time. So yes. if they are 25 or 24, 23, 26, 27, these guys, they grew up with this thing in their hand. I mean, they actually know what a cell phone is from the cradle, right? And so They had the world brought to them right then. I'm 53, so I'm old. I had a phone on the wall. I mean, we had to turn it out. So I never got any of that. But you got these young folks who believe in it, who believe that if I'm educated, I can be another Barack Obama. But the racial injustice, the systemic racism in our country has been a very, a very telling story to them. Now, I think a lot of them, and that's why you see a lot of them out there marching, saying, wait a minute, it's not right.
Right.
It's not right. And so what would you tell a young sister who got a fresh degree, got a little bit of a mentoring experience, got some interning, and comes to California, wants to break into that thing, and she sees all these barriers? What do you say to her then?
Well, I will say this. Yes, you're right. Millennials have had a different life. I mean, I think it starts way back because everybody wanted their children to have something different than what they had, right? Regardless if that's better or not. What I will say is that, yes, they have a different way of looking at things. If they're not happy where they are, they'll go ahead and move. Like we were probably taught, you need to stay there for 30, 40 years, whatever, to make sure you get that retirement. So what I would say and what I do say, because we do take in people and we mentor them, and I do keep my doors open because I found it hard when I was starting to come out to find people that would support. I had a couple of very key people, but I make sure I'm there to explain to them that, yes, you may have access to this data or internet or this social media. You may have a different view or your life has done differently, but the fact remains is that you're going to run into barriers because of who you are. If you are female or you're of color, or gender, they don't like the gender, or it's all kind of things that will still come up, and you have to attack them in the way that will be with integrity, because this is not over. I mean, one thing I will say about the millennials, and I will give them two thumbs up and a hand clap and a spin, that they were out there on the lines marching and try to do what we can for Black Lives Matter. So I have hope for them, and I know that they're great. And I've worked with some now that are amazing, and they just need us to be patient and have some guidance, and then try to hopefully they'll listen to the experience that we've had. So it's going to be tough. I don't think we're out of it at all. We have a long way to go, but we have to start learning more to, as the, what we can call the elders, to tell them and help them and guide them and teach them and hand it down. A lot of us are not doing that, and that's just doing a disservice to us all. So that's what I would say to our millennials, is to stay focused, stay, you know, and actually have a mentor and actually ask questions and don't feel like you know everything, because, you know, nobody does. So that's what I would say to them.
And I think you hit it on the head, especially with those young Black girls who are really wanting to break into this corporate structure. Mm-hmm. They may say, well, I may want to do own my own business one day, but right now I want to see what I can do in that corporate world. And I think your life has been a living example. I'm just glad to hear that you are mentoring young sisters out there, because of course they need it. And I've seen them on the front lines of Black Lives Matter, the movement. I'm talking about the movement in and of itself. They're out there, they're marching. Day in, they're still marching, and I just say two thumbs, like you said, two thumbs up. I don't know how they do it. I saw a video the other day of a young lady that was being arrested by the police, and she broke away from her, and then she stood there. She took a man, she stood there, and they were beating her with batons, but she stood there until she couldn't stand anymore. And I'm saying, that's my daughter right there. That's my 21-year-old daughter right there, because I'm saying, yes, she stood for something. So, hey, you know, and speaking of Black Lives Matter, I know Oakland has been a leader in terms of the Black community for years and years and years. I mean, you got the Huey guy,
Black Panthers.
Black Panthers. I don't want to go there. Those guys made it where we could actually say no more, right? And they said, we're going to defend our communities. We are going to feed our communities. We're going to uplift our communities. Oakland's one of those cities. And I'm just, that's why I have an issue with this gentrification, how now all of a sudden they're moved out toward, what is it, Hayworth, I think it is?
Antioch,
outside of Oakland, how it was so easy just to move a people.
Yes. You know, we are definitely a fighting city. A lot of stuff started here. One thing I do want to say before I answer the rest of this is that I think it's really important that people really know their history. I say this all the time because you know that we didn't learn anything much in school. You have to take the initiative and learn more of the history, understand where we come from, understand what we've had, understand what was taken from us. And the reason why this came up is because I have some friends that are not from here. They came from islands, and some of the stuff I would hear, they would say, oh, well, you know, you guys don't take advantage of this wonderful country. And so I just tell them, you know, instead of getting upset and mad, I just say, hey, stop for a second and really learn the history and see, you know, and see what caused certain things, because then that'll help you move through the rest of this. Right. And that, I think, is key. Here's some serious history here in Oakland. I think what have occurred is that we had some actual people in power, mayors, that they had a plan. They wanted to use the city as a platform to show what they could do. And they did. And now they set a whole plan together. And each year, more companies are coming in. And I know most people are like, this is great for the city, which it is. But I really wish that we could have had a little more stake in the game as African-Americans, because before, this city was just left behind. I mean, of course, they were like, oh, we're going to leave it for desolate. And we stayed. And now everybody's coming back, but we're getting left behind again. So those are the key pieces that I wish we could have, but we need to do that now, because however we can, we need to get our foot back in that door and make sure that we can make that our people are still here. Because eventually, if you don't, then we won't be here. It won't be Oakland, how people used to sit here and talk about Oakland. It won't be. So,
I know so many people, and I, for some odd reason, I know more people, Black folks, that family moved to Oakland than LA.
Yeah.
Literally. Because back in the day, in the 70s and the early 80s, it was a little bit more welcoming because there were so many more of us there, right?
Yes.
Of course, LA is so daggum spread out. So you don't know where you're not living in LA. You're living in Long Beach or wherever, you know, but you're in San Bernardino County. But I'm glad to hear you say that I'm hoping that at some point that the leadership of the city of Oakland will remember that before this gentrification, and corporations coming in is fantastic. It's great. We need great jobs. But we also need the fabric of the community still, too. We need those Black churches.
Yes.
We need those fraternities and sororities to be still there. You know, we still need all of that. And so don't leave them behind. But hey, that's just my two cents. I'm on the other side of the Mississippi.
No, but you're right. And a lot of people did move here, because if you think about it, there was the train station here, big deal here, the port down here in Oakland. Then you have a lot of people who moved to Richmond because of the same things. There was jobs. I know that even my mom from Louisiana and her family, they moved from there and was in Richmond first. So, I mean, there's a lot of people that moved here from different places for those reasons. And I saw pictures doing an event in Oakland and getting to know the city more. I saw gorgeous photos of how it looked and what it was. And so then when I got here going to school, I was just so saddened by seeing, because I didn't know Oakland, and people kept going, don't go to Oakland, don't go to Oakland. And of course, because, you know, I don't listen to everybody all the time, but I went ahead and I went, and I saw people of color, brown people running the lake. And I just fell in love. So I said, I'm going to live here. I'm going to buy a house here and support. And yes, may I say now that sometimes I feel like they could care if I did, but that's not going to, you know, make me move or make me not still fight for my city. And that's why we're helping our own get homes and helping our kids to be successful and to make sure people want to stay here, especially people of color.
You said Louisiana. So your family's from Louisiana, your mother's side?
My mother, yeah. My dad, she was Shreveport, Louisiana. Shreveport.
Way down. They got computers the size of cars in Shreveport, Louisiana. Trust me. You don't want to go. My family's from Lafayette. They up north, but you don't want to go to Shreveport. No. Oil, gas, and mosquitoes. I mean, I think that's the industry they have. I think they make cars down there. I'm not sure.
It was and my dad's from Chicago, so it was Shreveport, Chicago, and in Chicago, and some of his family's from Trinidad, so it was a mixture of everything.
Oh, great. Yeah. Wow, you got it all going on right there. And let's talk a little bit about your, you talked earlier about, you said you got COVID. What can tell us about it? What does it look like? What does it feel like? How devastating was it to you from a physical standpoint and also an emotional standpoint? I don't know anybody physically that has had COVID, but I'd like for you to share your story so that people can know what it's like and what you really don't want to do, and why it's so important to stay masked up, why it's so important to wash your hands, and why it's so important to social distance when you absolutely have to do it.
Sure. I will say I was traveling. I won't say where I was traveling from because I don't want to start any mess in that.
She wasn't in Memphis. She wasn't in Memphis. No,
it wasn't Memphis. Believe me, it wasn't. I had an event going on in a place that was a very big city, and I was starting to feel sick. And I thought it was just a regular cold. I was like, oh, shoot, I'm cold. Because I have been doing so many events. It was Black History Month. We just did a whole bunch here. I jumped on a plane, went to go do a work, and had to get back. This was in the beginning of March. And so they really did not know and have stuff ready available. So my doctor at the time, I was on the plane, and the plane just, made it worse. And so when I got home, I went and voted, and I went to the house, and I didn't leave the house for 19 weeks after that.
Weeks.
Oh gosh, yes, yes.
How many months is that, Lord? That's four.
Yes, that's over thing. Yes.
Really?
It was 19, yeah. So I'm excited that I was able to get out a few months to do these events. But how it felt was I thought I had a very serious flu. They thought I may have what they call the walking pneumonia or a respiratory infection. So they gave me antibiotics. It still wasn't moving. My sorority sister's a doctor. She was, we were having a call, and she decided, Deanna, you do not look good. She started jumping on here trying to help. You have to have people advocate for you because it's important. I was like, I can handle this. I could barely get upstairs to walk upstairs. I could barely breathe. So I have at the house like a little small breathing machine thing that we use. I have a Peloton bike. So they wanted me to get on that to help with my lungs. It felt achy, really bad. Now, did I lose taste and all that? I don't recall, but I wasn't eating, so I couldn't tell you. Wow. And I thought it was just a cold, but then it got worse. And the thing that they're saying right now for me is I took two tests. It was negative. Then I had to end up doing another. And that's when we found out. And they feel like right now that I'm what they call a COVID long hauler because of the fact that it stays around and hasn't left. So I'm still trying to get it together. I'm a lot stronger. I was talking to people.
You look fantastic.
Thank you.
You don't look like what you've been through. I mean, I'm just from my visual here. That's why when I was talking, you said, what did she say? I'm like, really?
Yeah. Well, thank you. I appreciate that because before, and you would hear my voice and I sound like Barry White. Or I couldn't talk. Then I will just say this. It was such a blessing that I did not have to go into the hospital because I think if I would have, I would have been on. I know people, I have friends who lost people from it and they were in the hospital and never came out. So I was really scared. My mind was foggy. I still had to continue to call clients and move them to postpone things. My staff was helping. I still had school. So it was hard. It was a very hard struggle. And so when people say this is a hoax or they say that it's not really anything serious or I could be around you or they wear their mask like under their nose, all I have to say is this. You don't want what I had gone through or what other people have gone through. And some of them did not make it. So this is not a joke. And we need to be serious about it. And if we don't, we'll still be sitting here in houses doing nothing.
Sure. How important was your support system being around you? Did your mom have an opportunity to come over? That's right. Because if you're contagious, no. You really don't. Oh my God, you on ICU?
I haven't seen my mommy, and I call her mommy. I haven't seen my mommy since we took her to see Oprah in February here, and that was the last Saturday in February. So I have not seen my mommy. I talked to her every day. She was, Face of course,
and so forth here and all that.
No, she doesn't do that. My mom's 83. She's not that. She had her prayer warriors praying for me because she's, you know, a mother of the church. That's but right. My sister would go over and then she would use her, you know, her phone to do it. But it's not the same. I miss Mother's Day, her birthday, all the above. So, but you know what? My mother's important to me. I can't lose her. She's all that I have left in regards as a parent. So I had to take it and I couldn't see her. So right now, since I was able to get out and do these events, I'm quarantining from going out and doing things for a little bit. And then probably in September, I'm going to see if I could do a drive-by because I've got to lay eyes on her. So that's what I'm going to do.
Can you imagine the strain on a parent who has a child who is sick and mm-hmm. they can't touch that child, especially one that birthed? I'm not talking about dad. I'm talking about the mother that birthed them. And yeah. I can only imagine the strain that was on her. You know, yours was tough. Not being able to see mama and get in mama's lap and lay there and cry. But yeah. Imagine mama not being able to come by and say, baby, it's all right. It's going to be okay.
Well, my mom is very emotional and I get that from her and she's really a sweetheart. I mean, I'm not just saying because she's my mom, but she just reaches out to all my friends. She does all that. So I know this is hard for her. And especially my sister's doing an awesome job because she lives not too far from my mom. I'm an hour and a half, an hour to 15 minutes away. So normally that would be super easy drive, but I know it's hard for her. That's why regardless, when I can speak, I call her twice a day. We talk, I check on her, make sure she's in. My sister goes over there. Tomorrow I'll see her on the computer because she's at my sister's house for something. So, you know, it's just been tough. And I know it's tough on her. And I'm telling you, people, just please just really think about it. I know you're getting tired of being in the house, but I was here for 19 weeks and my house probably was like, can you leave, please? Because I'm normally traveling so much. It wasn't used to me being here. So, you know, I understand it's a struggle, but we just need to stop for a second and get this done. And then not anybody else, because I'm not trying to have any more people I know pass away. It's just not good. And it's hard on the mental. The other key part you said was the mental health. It's tough here. I mean, I have to admit, I had to write in my journal why I was sick. I had to keep doing stuff because your mind starts just having, you know, it plays tricks on you when you're sick and also when you can't get out. And so I know that's what's happening to people. And that's why I'm saying, give people grace, everybody, and all this evil that we're doing. It's not good for us at all. And all this fighting and tearing each other down is not good because it's a lot of this COVID that's pushing this. And we need to really be aware of what we're doing to other people.
I like what you just said. You said, give people grace. I think, and this is just an opinion, but I think that when you have the highest office in the land and under God, individual, yes. Liberty, and justice for all.
Justice for all.
justice for some. But when you have the highest office in the land that does not extend that grace out, does not extend that hand out, and it's always something negative, and I would like to think, Deanna, that even his supporters, his followers, are not as dogmatic and as racist as it appears that a bunch of them are.
Right.
They're just good Americans. But number one, we were basically locked down in this country for 3 months. Some people lost everything they had, even yes. though you got a chance to forbear this. Some people are not used to not being able to pay their bills, and that worries them, right?
Yes.
And I know in your case, with staff and with a company, with this COVID piece, I know that more than likely bothered you as well, too, on top of COVID-19, right? And trying to right. deal with that and looking at all the racial injustice. Getting out of here, what would you say? I mean, Michelle Obama, I think she phrased it well the other day when she said, look, this president is not for us. He's not the one that's going to be able to lead us out of here. And she took a spin on his words and she said, and it is what it is.
I agree. She was amazing last night. I will say it touched my heart because last week I was a little saddened by responses that were made when they announced Senator Harris. And my feeling is just kind of like what Ava DuVernay said. It's like, at this point, the debating is over. We need to go ahead and support. And I just feel like it was more of a tear down of Black women. And even if you don't believe in the policies, you know, believe me, this has been, other people have done this to us for more than the years that she's been in office. You know, if you feel that she's done something, and it's just tough. So when I saw, you know, my forever first lady, Michelle Obama, her just passion and her just talking to the camera, she was just amazing. And I felt like what she said is was true. And I know that there are his supporters that have that really understand that there is an issue going on. And if they don't understand and they want to stand behind him, you know, that's your choice. But here's what I'm saying to the people who know better. We need to get out there and vote. And she's right. Vote like your life depends on it. Because right now, if we do have four more years, I sometimes feel like it might be an I Am Legend type of movie coming up, because we are really in a bad spot. And we don't even know the depths of it yet, because we're not seeing everything yet. And people just don't understand. And we need to take a back seat on, you know, you got him in there because you didn't like having President Obama, or you didn't like Hillary Clinton. You know, I don't know. But the thing is, right now, we need to vote, and we need to make sure that we get someone else in there and then put them to the task. If you feel like there's something that they don't do that you don't like, put them to the task, get involved. The key piece is that you have to get involved. You can't sit behind there with your fingers on the keys saying all this stuff and you're not out there doing anything. Then if you're doing something, then, hey, I'm like, okay. But if you're not doing anything, seriously, just get involved. And I say it all the time, stop trying to attack people, stop trying to question their ethnicity, and look at policies. And also remember, you got to also look at the Senate, because they are the ones who actually make a lot of these decisions, and you've got to make those changes too. It's not just one level. So let's get in here and vote and do what we have to do, and then you can push into the task.
See, you opened up a whole nother can of worms, and I didn't want to go there, but I'm going to go there with you before we get out. That's Kamala Harris, Senator Kamala Harris, a junior senator from California.
Yes.
And when she was announced a week or so ago, there was some talk. And I have to say this, there wasn't just talk. And I'm going to be, this is why we got Funky Politics, to kind of ferret these things out. And we have to hit ourselves sometimes when we're wrong.
Yes.
But there was a lot of talk in our community about, well, she's not a real sister. She's not this. She was a prosecutor. Well, that's what the hell they hired her for, was to prosecute.
Yes.
They didn't hire her to be the damn public defender. If they want her to be the damn public, they would have hired her the damn public defender for the state of California. But they hired her, and people don't realize that the attorney general's office, or the local attorney general, their job is to defend the state, and the state is the people.
Yeah.
And so, as someone who's worked in the criminal justice system before, I want people to understand that's what the prosecutor's job is. It's not to put someone in jail; it's to get the truth. And
right.
I think there are some things that maybe she could have done differently, probably. But now there's a couple of things I know she was not for the death penalty. Now, that's
right.
One thing. And they say, well, she was kind of cozy with the police department. Sometimes you have to be. But now we see what some of that has done to us, right? Being cozy in terms of, from a prosecutor standpoint and the law enforcement agency. But where do we go? How do we talk to our Black men about not tearing down our sisters, like Stacey Abrams in Georgia, who very well could be the governor of the state of Georgia right now? And I will say, I'm going to call it out like it is. 98% of Black women voted for Stacey Abrams. 94% of Black men voted for Stacey Abrams. You tell me why. And after that, I'm going home. I'll let you go home and finish taking your medication so you can lay down. Because I know it's hard out there. Come on, boy. It's hard out there. Hold up, hold up.
Yeah, man, but you're so funny. Like you said, you opened up a whole nother, which is a whole nother show.
There's a whole nother show, but we do have to have a conversation with ourselves. These types of platforms with Funky Politics, I think it's, and you, Deanna, and I think we have to start talking about self-love. You know, look, man, I would rather see her than a Mike Pence any day in that office. And I know that when Joe leaves, I know what we're getting ready to get, right?
Right. I say this. You hit the nail on the head, how they say it, on several things. We do have to have more self-love. We do need to get out of this whole mentality of crabs in the barrel. We've got to stop all these things that we have going on. That's what saddens me, because we don't love each other. We may say we do, but we don't. We know where that comes from. It stems from years and years and years. But right now, questioning her and saying she's not black enough and not this. I recall back learning in history or learning from family that one drop of black blood made you black. Okay. And I remember that was a whole major issue. Now we're saying, oh, well, maybe no. So I don't know. It just all of a sudden is weird how it all flips now to fit the narrative that people want. And she just said it on TV herself that he is having a black running, you know, vice president. So I don't know what else they people need her to do. I know that, of course, everyone's not perfect. No one's perfect. And she may have done some things that you may not have liked, but she felt they were right. So we need to also remember that, because no one is a perfect person. And the people before her were not perfect. That's what I'm saying. It's really weird how she's getting all this criticism, but I didn't see all this before on others. And it's just doesn't make sense. But I know what it's from, and I know people will be like, oh, you guys always say this, but you know, I could start quoting Malcolm X in a second if you like, but it talks about how, you know, about black women. And I don't like to always go there, but we do have to look at ourselves as a community, and we need to start supporting each other more. And yes, if you don't like it and you don't like what she's done, then you know what, get in there and make a change. Help her get in, change it. I do know she understands some things that may have gone differently, but let her show you that she can do what she can do. I feel like if we to get through this so that we aren't in a I Legend situation, she can get in there and help clean up what's going on. You were excited about her when she was in doing all the testimonies and having people testify for stuff, and she was at them. You were fine with that, right? But now you're not. So I'm just confused.
Right. Yeah,
I'm just confused. So we need to really look at ourselves in the mirror and say, hey, why are we doing this? You know, because it's not fair. It's not fair to her. It's not fair to anybody, but we continue to do it. And it's just sad. It just hurt my heart last week. And then so when I saw my first lady, she was awesome. And I hope that people will start to just say, okay, let's just do this. And then let's get in there and start working.
Well, you know what? I know you got to get out of here. We got to get out of here also. But I want to just throw one other point out there. And that is that, you know, Shirley Chisholm in 72 ran for president.
Yes.
They didn't take her seriously. Geraldine Ferraro ran on the Democratic ticket with Mondale for vice president. Sarah Palin, in all of her grandeur, she can see Russia from her backyard.
Yes.
Still, there were some instances where we did not sit well with, and it may be a woman's thing, and I think men have got to get to that point. And I'm a man, and I will admit there's sometimes when I've said some things that were not kosher at all. But we have got to start changing. I think it goes back to self-love, number one. And women have run this. Women are running this country. They run the church. They run these jobs. They run me. And
so let me tell you
right now, hey, and you running stuff out there in Oakland right now. We're going to get out of here, Deanna. I love you being on the phone. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
This conversation has been coming for some time. I'm glad we got you in here. Prayers to you.
Thank you.
On your recovery. At some point, as I said before, when I come out to Oakland, I want you to take me over to Sausalito so I can go get me some of them good ribs. Oh, I'm not going to ribs up there. Some good lobster.
Well, you know what? I will say this. I have quite a few friends here in Oakland who opened up some actual restaurants that you would love. They're black women, and I have some that are not black women, but my sisters that I am friends with, their stuff is so amazing. So when you come out, you have to go. You can go to Sausalito, of course, but you've got to come to Oakland and check it out. And you have to go to a few other locations that I have in San Francisco and that are further out. So we'll make sure you get the full experience.
That's when you go. Thank you so much for being on Funky Politics. Have a great day, Deanna. Thank you.
Dad. All right, you too. Thank you so much. I appreciate you having me on.
All right. And I'll be back with some closing thoughts in just a second.
Okay. Have a good one.
Funky Politics.
R&R on Sports.
Brother Rashad McCants, welcome to R&R on Sports.
Thanks for having me, brother.
It's R&R on Sports.
R&R. Let me tell you something. There is nothing that I love better than having a great interview with a great guest and Deanna Roberts, who is the event doctor, by the way. I want to make sure you know she is the event doctor, and that the sister is down. She is doing some wonderful work, not only on the West Coast, but she's doing this all over the world. You heard what she said. Man, I tell you, I'm floored by it. But I'm mostly proud of the fact that she's a thought leader and that she mentors these young Black sisters to make sure that they know that there's a we can make it. Just stay the course. We're going to make it. She's had a bout with COVID-19, and she is winning that bout. You saw her. She's winning that bout, and I'm so glad for it. But she also said that, look, you have to do some things. And she said that it's serious. The social distancing is a must. She's been in the house for 19 weeks is what she said. God, I can only imagine that. In the house for 19 weeks, sheltered in place. Been in the house. Social distancing is a norm. Washing your hands is a norm, and wearing your mask is a norm. Let's help stay together by being apart. We can stay together by being apart. And that's what I'd like to leave you with today. We've got a lot of social unrest in our country. We've got a lot of upheaval in our country. We've got a president who thinks that he is the dictator. But come November 3rd, I'm assuming that there will be a lot of folks that say that, to the contrary, that you are not sure what we want, and we'll be doing something different. So until next time, come back and see me. I'm DC. This is Funky Politics on the Kudzukian Network. And man, catch you again.
Funky Politics, recorded at Kudzukian Studios, directed, produced, and distributed by Kudzukian.